واللعنة الدائمة الباقي على أعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم وغاصب حقوقهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، ألف لام ميم، أحسب الناس أن يتركوا أن يقولوا آمنا وهم لا يفتنون. صلوات من أكبر. This is a Thursday night which falls during the day of Aza. We just commemorated the Arba'een of Sayyid al-Shuhada, salawatullah alayhi. And it's also a Salah Sawab Majlis for the various marhumin, especially for the two, the mu'min and a mu'mina, whose jahlum is being observed tonight. And I thought it's appropriate to talk about the important issue that everyone faces in life, and that is about this question that why we are in this dunya. What is the purpose of our life in this world? There are different ways of looking at it, but a simple way of explaining that is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends us to this dunya to give us the opportunity to prove our worth for the salvation in the hereafter. This is a temporary abode for us. The hereafter is the eternal abode for us. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I want you to go there in a better situation based on what you prove yourself to be. So you can understand the importance of your own status and your worth in the hereafter. He has given us the potential, he has shown us the way, and he says that the way of, you know, attaining that salvation in the hereafter is basically by overcoming the hurdles in following the path shown to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the Anbiya, through the Anbiya and the Mursaleen, and the guidance of the Imams. This issue of overcoming the hurdles and the barriers in life, this is basically something which we call test and trial. Imtihan, ibtila. Qur'an uses the words bala and fitna. In Farsi, Urdu, Gujarati, we use the word fitna in different meaning. Fitna has actually 10 different meanings. But in most of the places where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about human life, he's talking about fitna in the meaning of test and trial. Bala also is in the same meaning, ibtila. He is putting us in a situation where we have to overcome the hurdles in order to basically prove our worth. And he has given us that potential to do that. If you look at the ayat from Surah Mulk, right at the beginning, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Tabarak alladhi biyadihi al-mulk wa huwa ala kulli shayin qadir, blessed is the one in whose hand is the kingdom of the universe. And he has power over everything. الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةِ And he is the one who has created death and life. For what? One word. لِيَبْلَؤُكُمْ So that he may test you. Put you through test and trial. To see أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا Who among you is doer of good deeds. Better deeds. وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْغَفُورِ He is the powerful. He is monitoring us. He has the ability to monitor whatever we do. Of course, he is also al-ghafoor and forgiving. And so here we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using the word yabla'a. Yabla'a is from bala. This is the verb form of the term bala, to put us in test and trial. The ayat that I recited earlier after the khutbah from Surah Ankabut, this is also the earlier ayat of Surah Ankabut, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alif Lam Mim, أَحَسِبَ الَّذِينَ أَحَسِبَ النَّاسَ أَنْ يُتْرَكُوا أَنْ يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا Do the people think that they will be just left alone by saying Amen, by verbally declaring their iman? No, wahum la yuftanun, and they think they will not be put into fitna. Yuftanun is the verb form. That do they think that they will not be put into test and trial? Of course not. لَقَدْ فَتَّنَّ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. The ayat goes on that verily we have put others before you into test and trial. And so this dunya basically is for going through various challenges and hurdles in our life in order to follow the path known as path of, you know, Siraat Mustaqeem. Tonight, let me, you know, go to a statement from Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. And for those who want to follow this later on, this is the Nahjul Balagha, saying number 93. Very powerful when he talks about this issue of test and trial and fitna. It seems somebody probably was doing a dua and praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-fitna. O Allah, I seek protection with you against fitna. Fitna in the meaning of test and trial. And Amir al-Mu'minin here says, la yaqulanna ahadukum, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-fitna. None of you should ever say, that, O Allah, I seek your protection against fitna, against test and trial. Why? لِأَنَّهُ لَيْسَ أَحَدٌ إِلَّا هُوَ مُشْتَلِمٌ عَلَى الْفِتْنَةِ. Because there is no one who is not involved in one kind or another kind of test and trial and fitna. And so you can't do the dua that, O Allah, you know, protect me from fitna. It means, O Allah, exempt me from exam. But there is no exemption here. If you want the result at the end, you have to go through the exam. So to do dua that, O Allah, you know, I seek your protection against fitna, is as if you want to say, O Allah, exempt me from the exam. No, that is not going to happen. Then he says, وَلَكِنْ مَنْ اسْتَعَاذَ فَلْيَسْتَعِذْ. If anybody wants to do this dua of seeking protection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَلْيَسْتَعِذْ مِنْ مُضِلَّاتِ الْفِتَنِ, then he should actually pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for Allah's protection against the misguidance in the fitna and the test and trial. Means we cannot avoid test and trial. That is going to be there. But there are two ways of handling it. Either we overcome it wisely by following the path with the difficulties, or you go in a way which is not right. And that is where we seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's protection, that even in this situation of temptation, in the situation of test and trial, O Allah, keep me away from the misguidance at that time. And this is where, you know, Amir al-Mu'minin is basically saying that test and trial, ibbala and fitna, imtihan and ibtila, are essential parts of our life. There is no escape from it. The only thing we have to worry about in our prayer is that, O Allah, you know, keep me away from the misguidance in situations of tension and pressure. Salawat Pranay Akbar. Then he gives an example from the Quran. Ali says that, you know, there are different kinds of test and trial that we go through. And this is where he says, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ يَقُولُ. Verily, the glorified Allah says, وَعَلَمُ أَنَّمَا أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَأَوْلَادُكُمْ فِتْنَةً. وَعَلَمُ. Verily, you should know. This is an ayat of Quran from Surah number 8, ayat 28, that you verily you should know that your wealth and your children are fitna for you. Again, not in the meaning of Urdu and Gujarati here. No, in the meaning of test and trial. Means when Allah gives us the wealth, there is imtihan in it. When He gives us the children, there is imtihan in it. And then Amir al-Mu'minin explains, وَمَعْنَا ذَلِكَ أَنَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ يَخْتَبِرُهُمْ بِالْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَوْلَادِ. It means that Allah is testing them through the wealth and the children that He has given to them. لِيَتَبَيَّنَ السَّاخِطُ لِرِزْقِهِ وَالرَّاضِي بِقِسْمِهِ. So that he may be able to distinguish a person who is displeased with his blessings and the person who is content and pleased with Allah, what Allah has given to him. And so the test of wealth, for example, or even children, would be to see whether we are grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not. Are we content and happy with what Allah has given to us? Or are we just complaining all the time? And so even by giving things like wealth or children, that is also a way of test and trial for us. And this is where we have to realize, when He blesses, there is imtihan in it. If He restrains our sources financially, there is imtihan in it. When you are rich, there is imtihan in it. When you are poor, there is imtihan in it. When you have health, there is imtihan in that. When you are sick, there is imtihan in it. If you are a humble, simple person, nobody knows you, there is imtihan in that humility. If you are a famous person and a person in position of power, there is imtihan with it. In whatever situation you find yourself, Allah is testing the individual to see how he or she is reacting in that given situation. And this is where, you know, why? Doesn't he already know? What is the need for the exam? The whole issue of justice comes in. If he doesn't put us through test and trial, and then according to his knowledge, and looking at our potential, says, I'm going to give you the gradings, failure or pass, and send one to Jahannam and one to Jannah, those who go into Jahannam will complain. He says, at least you should have given me the opportunity. You didn't give me the chance. You just assume that this is what I'm going to do. And so the justice demands that we go through this phase of this life. Different hurdles, different challenges in our life. People are tested in different ways. Why? This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the words of Ali, he says, وَإِنْ كَانَ سُبْحَانَهُ أَعْلَمَ بِهِمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Although Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows them better than what they know about themselves. He knows us more than what we know about ourselves. وَلَكِنْ لِتَظْحَرَ الْأَفْعَالَ الَّتِي بِهَا يُسْتَحَقُّ الثَّوَابَ وَالْإِقَابَ. But he does this in order to bring out the actions through which reward and punishment is earned. He wants us to do things. He wants us actually to do things in the right way so that he can reward us. And if we do not react to the situation in the right way, then there is the issue of punishment. Even in the ayat in Surah Al-Kabut, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَحَسِبَ النَّاسِ. Do people think that, you know, just by saying amanna, it is sufficient and that he is not going to test them? No. He has tested those who were before them. فَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ الْكَاذِبِينَ. Because Allah wants to distinguish the true believers from the liars. Liars means those who just say amanna but do not act according to it. And so the imtihan is not because he doesn't know. It's just to justify this process of reward and punishment in the hereafter. And this is where Amir al-Mu'min then gives an example where he says, when he gives us wealth or children, he wants to see whether we are content and pleased or we are ungrateful and, you know, not pleased with his sustenance and his blessings. He says there are some who only like male children. If you give them daughters, they don't like. This is imtihan. How we react to it. And, you know, these are not just trivial things that, you go to, just look around. In different cultures around the world, even among Muslims. especially when mothers feel bad about it, when, you know, mother-in-laws feel full, you know, are so upset when the daughter-in-law has a daughter. Baba, you had a daughter also. They forget the reality. But this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testing the people by giving them a child. Are you only happy with a male child and you are displeased when you are given a daughter? That's also imtihan. So imtihan is not only in suffering, imtihan is also when Allah is blessing us. And this is where we have to realize that there is no choice. No one is exempted, not even Anbiya and Mursaleen and the Aimma, not even the greatest of all the Prophet, Hazrat Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even he is not exempted from ibtila and imtihan. So there is no escape from this. The only thing we can pray in the words of Ali, that Allah, in situations that you put me, give me the courage and the wisdom to react in the right way at that given situation. When we talk about, you know, test and trial, of course, I just use this example from the statement of Amir al-Mu'mineen, where he talks about mal and awlad. But there are different categories, actually, of test and trial. There is a very important ayat in Surah Baqarah, ayat number 155 to 157, which is kind of a summary of what kinds of test and trial that Allah can put us through it. And this is very interesting, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the word bala here. And the ayat begin with the words, وَلِنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ. There is double, triple emphasis there. The word lam before this verb is for emphasis. The extra noon at the end of the verb is again for emphasis. So if you really want to do a literal translation of this word, you should say, surely, verily. Although in English it doesn't sound normal, but this is how the literal emphasis would be there. That surely and verily we are going to test you, put you in ibtila, put you in bala, bishay'in, from different kinds of, you know, test and trial, different challenges in life. Number one, min al-khawf. He talks about fear, referring to social insecurity. You know, we relatively, alhamdulillah, are much, you know, comfortable here, but there are different situations in the world. You know, look at even the Shias, for example, let alone many, many other communities and countries around the world, who go through different tests and trials. Shias in Iraq, the Shias in Bahrain, the Shias in Pakistan, where the mothers don't know the children going to school, they will come back alive or not. Wives don't know the husband who is going will be, you know, will come back okay. And these are the situations where Allah is testing the zalim as well as the mazlum. The zalim will be held accountable for the zulm that he is doing. And the mazlum will be tested to see how he is reacting in that given situation. The second category, waljoo, hunger. It's not necessary that fear and hunger are imposed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no. These are mostly man-made situations where people inflict, you know, fear and hunger on others. Because hunger is a result of social inequality. When people do not, you know, pay their share from what Allah has given to them, do not, you know, share with the less fortunate members of the community, that's where poverty and hunger comes. So it's not that Allah is imposing this, no, but when the situation is there, even man-made situations, Allah says, okay, you are a victim here, and there is a zalim on the other side. I am testing both of you to see how you are reacting in this kind of situation. Then he says the third one, وَنَقْصٍ مِنَ الْأَمْوَالِ. He says, sometimes I will test you by poverty, loss of wealth. People go through different situations in their lives. Not everybody is same all the time. You know, sometimes they were affluent, well-to-do, then things change. Whether it's because of their own doing, mismanagement, or whatever. And then, you know, they don't have much. Naqsin min al-amwal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when I gave you, I was testing you. Now that you are in restrained position, I'm going to test you. Are you maintaining your iman or not? Are you maintaining your morality or not? And then, wal anfus. Anfus means life. And this actually means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the life. He will take it. But sometimes when it comes to our own nafs, our own body, Allah says, even in your body, I'm going to test you. When I give you sihhat and health, that is one imtihan, to see how you are using it. Are you fulfilling the demands of the body or not? Are you fulfilling the duties which are imposed on you or not? But sometimes situations change. A person is afflicted with an illness, whether it's temporary or long-term. You know, sometimes it is curable, sometimes it is incurable. In all situations, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is fitna, this is bala. This is one way that He would test you. And then going on, wasthamarat, loss in property, loss in life and the body, and the loss in fruits. The word thamarat here doesn't mean the fruits on the tree, it means the fruits of our heart, referring to the children. By giving the children, that's one imtihan. When he says, al-mal wal-awlad fitna. Now here he's saying, naqsun min al-amwali wal-anfusi wal-thamarat. This is also an imtihan. He might give you a child, but then he will take the child away. Situation happens that, you know, you lose the child. And that is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test you at that time. And these challenges, actually, there is a very interesting discussion by Syed Murtaza Mutahhiri. In his book on divine justice, where he talks about suffering, he brings out this point that from the Islamic point of view, based on the ahadith, you know, the sufferings that we go through in different, you know, situations, actually is a potential of bringing out the best in a human being. A very simple example I'll give. If you go to one of these, you know, hardware stores and buy a spade for gardening, a brand new one, hanging in your garage, you don't use it there, it's there for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. Go and look at it. You will see, you know, it'll start getting rusted. But if you use it again and again, especially the front part, which is hitting the ground again and again, you will see it stays, shining. This is where when you are put into tension and difficulty, you know, your real worth shines out. If everything is normal all the time, well, who knows? Sometimes we are put into situations individually. Sometimes we are put into situations as a community. And we have gone through this just 2 years ago. That time is the time of imtihan, to see how we are reacting. Are we reacting in the right way or the wrong way? And this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sometimes when He puts us into ibtala and fitna in that way, remember He will never impose a challenge, a difficulty, a bala, a fitna on anyone beyond their capacity. And this is where, you know, we have to realize that, you know, imtihan are of all different kinds. Sometimes the ahkam in our sharia are imtihan. Sometimes issues in the creative world is imtihan. Namaz is imtihan for us. Fasting is imtihan for us. Going for Hajj is test and trial. Paying the charity in form of zakat and khums and other things and fitrah, this is imtihan for us. But then when it comes to our own personal life, health and, you know, sickness, affluence and poverty, security and insecurity, these are all situations of our life which is also, this becomes a case of imtihan and ibtila for us. And this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I would like to see how you are reacting in a given situation. This ayat is very beautifully where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after describing these five categories or types of imtihan and ibtila, then he says, what do I expect you in this situation to do? He says, I would like you to maintain sabr and patience. If you're able to maintain sabr and patience, then you will react in the right way. And therefore, the next sentence there is, وَبَشِّرُ الصَّابِرِينَ. After saying that I'm going to surely test you in this through these different ways and methods, then Allah says to the Prophet, وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. Give good news to those who are sabirin, who exercise patience. And who are these people? الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ. These are the people when suffering comes upon them, musibat. We recite masaib at the end in the majlis. When a suffering or a musibat comes on them, they immediately remember the purpose of this dunya, why we are here, and they utter the words, qalu inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. They always remind themselves that inna lillahi, we belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has sent us to this dunya so that we may be able to, you know, manifest the potential which is within us, the worth which is there in inside us, and wa inna ilayhi raji'un, and one day we are going to go back to him, and he will remember how we reacted in different situations, and inshallah he is going to accept it and reward us accordingly in that eternal life. What will happen to them? Those who exercise sabr in these situations, ulaika, three things will happen to them. Ulaika alayhim salawatun min rabbihim. Number one, salawat will come to them from Allah. Salawat means blessings. Allah will bless them. Wa rahmatun, and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come to them. Wa ulaika humul muhtadun, and they will be the rightly guided one. They will be given extra guidance. If you really are able to overcome the burdens in your life in the right way, in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will see that Allah will give you more wisdom, more courage, and extra guidance to continue on the path. And that is the guarantee of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so when we, you know, talk about different situations that we see in life, we remember always the words of Amir al-Mu'mineen, we can never escape from test and trial. People are tested in different ways. One person might just be tested through one method of the five methods, for example, mentioned here. Another might be going through a double imtihan. And those who are going through double imtihan should not say, you know, why me? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala considers you worthy of it, capable of that. If you didn't have the potential of going through it, he would not put you in that. That's in a way recognition of your potential. This is how you should look at it, and then you will be able to overcome it. And this is where sabr comes in, and you will be able to understand it in a better way. It is very rare that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would impose all or use all different kinds of, you know, methods of imtihan and ibtila at the same time on one person. The way we see in Karbala, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says khawf, insecurity. There was no amen there. Thousands of enemies surrounding a small group, especially the women and the children. For them, there were absolutely no amen and peace and security there. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about jua, hunger. They were denied water and food. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about naqs min al amwal wal anfus wa thamarat, loss in wealth, loss in lives, loss of children. All these things were happening on the same day, at the same place, to the same person in form of Hussein bin Ali alayhi salatu wasalam. And this is where we see the greatness of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Allah considered him to be worthy of going through that. Remember his words after the shahadat of his infant. He didn't complain. Sabr doesn't mean not to cry. Sabr doesn't mean you should not cry. Sabr means don't utter the words of complaint against the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what did Hussein say at that time? When he was carrying the 6-month-old baby in his hand. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Same words which is in that ayat of Ibtila. Ridhan biqaba'ihi, O Allah, whatever is your will, I submit to it. Wa tasliman li amrih. And I submit and give in to your command. Whatever you ask me to do, I will do it. And this is where we have to realize that yes, you know, we go through test and trial in different ways. You know, for us, always Karbala is that ocean of masaib, where we link to that in order to understand and relate to the suffering that we are going through ourselves. And that is why we have this, you know, silsila of, you know, azadari and majlis when we lose somebody who is dear and near to us. It is a way of understanding, you know, the whole purpose of life and the way of trying to understand, you know, the masaib of Karbala, which were the greatest of the masaib. Nothing, you know, something like this happened in any place. And this is where we can get kind of a consolation, gives us the courage to move forward and pray for those who have passed away in this test and trial of this dunya. Ayyam-e Aza hain. Aur baat masaib mein imtihan aur ibtila aur sabr ki hai. Hussain ka zikr humne kiya hai. Lekin hum chahte hain ki is Ayyam-e Aza ke munasibat se ahle haram ko bhi hum yaad kar lein. Aap soch lein janab-e Zainab ki kaifiyat kya thi. Ek din mein ek life ke loss ki baat nahi ho rahi. Ek din mein khandan ke 18 afraad, jisme do bete bhi hain, bhatije bhi hain, bhai bhi hain, khandan ke dusre afraad bhi hain. Aur na sirf mardon ke shahadat ki baat hai, بلکہ مان کو لوٹا گیا. اہل حرم پر ظلم ہوتا ہے. چادروں کو لوٹا گیا. بھوک و پیاس کا مسئلہ تھا. تمام مصائب جو ہیں ایک جگہ جمع ہو گئے. اور اس کے بعد جب قیدی اور اسیر بنایا گیا ہے, یہ جو کہا جاتا ہے صبر, صبر کی مثال کیا ہے کہ جب یہ قافلہ ابن زیاد کے سامنے پیش کیا گیا ہے کوفہ میں, اور وہ پوچھتا ہے یہ کون ہے, یہ کون ہے, اور وہ خاتون کون ہے جو کنیزوں میں گھیر گری ہوئی ہے کونے میں, کہا گیا ہذہ زینب بنت علی, کہ یہ زینب بنت علی ہے. ملعون آگے بڑھتا ہے اور ایک سوال کرتا ہے. آپ سوچ لیں کہ اس حالت میں اموشنل سچویشن زینب کی کیا تھی. کیف رعیتی فعل اللہ بأہل بیتک, اے فاطمہ تم نے اللہ کے اس عمل کو تیرے خاندان کے بارے میں کیا پایا ہے؟ کیا جواب دیتی؟ وہ مشہور جملہ جو شیخ مفید نے کوٹ کیا ہے اس سلسلے میں کہ ان تمام مصائب کو جھیلنے کے بعد خاندان میں 18 افراد شہید ہو جاتے ہیں، اسیر اور قیدی بن جاتی ہیں، بھوک اور پیاس کا معاملہ ہے، لیکن جواب یہی تھا کہ ما رأیت الا جمیلا، جہاں تک خدا کی ذات ہے، خدا کے عمل کی بات ہے، فعل اللہ کی بات کر رہے ہو، ما رأیت الا جمیلا، سوائے جمال اور خوبصورتی کے خداوند عالم کے اعمال میں ہم نے اور عمل میں کچھ نہیں دیکھا ہے. ہاں خدا نے انسانوں کو مبتلا کیا تھا، میرے اہل بیت اور میرے گھر والے سامنے گئے ہیں، شہادت کو اپنایا ہے، اور ایک دن آئے گا حساب کتاب کا کہ جہاں ان کو اور جو قاتلین ہیں ان کو سامنے لایا جائے گا، اور اس وقت اللہ فیصلہ کرے گا. لیکن یہ جملہ کہ اس وقت بھی فعل اللہ کے بارے میں ما رأیت الا جمیلا، ہم نے خدا کے عمل میں اور ارادے میں سوائے خوبصورتی کے اور کچھ نہیں دیکھا ہے، یہ صرف زینب کہہ سکتی ہے. عزداران حسین، چونکہ چہلم کی مجلس ہے مرحومہ اور مرحوم کی، اور جو بھی اپنے زندگی میں وہ بھی ایک سفرنگ کے مراحل سے گزرے ہیں، لیکن ان کے خاندان والوں کے لیے صرف اتنا کہیں گے کربلا ہمارے لیے اس لیے مرہم ہے کہ ہمارا لوس اپنے جگہ پہ ہے، یقیناً لوس ہے، صرف ٹائم ہی ہے جو ہیلنگ فیکٹر ہے، لیکن اگر واقعات کربلا کو ذہن میں رکھیں تو کچھ سکون مل سکتا ہے. آپ اس خاتون کو یاد کریں کہ اہل حرم میں سب سے مظلومہ خاتون تھی، جن کا نام ہے جناب رباب. یہ قافلہ جب شام سے کربلا آیا ہے اور کربلا کی زیارت کے بعد جب یہ مدینہ جانے کی بات ہوئی، روایات نہیں بیان کرتی ہیں لیکن یقیناً ہر بی بی کے دل میں یہ احساس ہوگا کہ اب ہم وطن جائیں گے، گھر پہنچیں گے، اور گھر پہنچنے کا یہ احساس ہوتا ہے خوشی کا. لیکن ایک خاتون تھی جو کربلا میں یقیناً ان کے لیے بہت ہی مشکل مرحلہ تھا کہ جب کس طرح سے امام زین العابدین اور جناب زینب نے سمجھایا ہوگا رباب کو کہ اب قافلہ مدینہ جانے کے لیے تیار ہے، چلے، رباب نے عجب نہیں کہ یہی کہا ہوگا کہ آخر ہم مدینہ کس کے لیے جائے، میرے شوہر یہاں دفن ہو چکے ہیں، میرا ششمات یہاں دفن ہو چکا ہے، شوہر کی ایک یاد تھی 4 سال کی بیٹی، لیکن وہ زندہ نے شام میں ہم نے دفن کر کے آئے ہیں، مدینہ اب جائے تو کس لیے جائے، کس طرح سے زینب نے سمجھایا ہے، جس پس زینب کا خدا جانتا ہے. جناب رباب کے دل پر یہ صدمہ اتنا گہرا تھا کہ مدینہ پہنچنے کے بعد صرف 2 سال زندہ رہی اور دن کے وقت کبھی بھی سائے میں نہیں بیٹھتی تھی، صحن میں آ جاتی تھی. بیبیاں جب سمجھاتی تھی بس ایک ہی جملہ تھا، میرے مولا کا لاشا کربلا میں 3 دن تک بے گور کفن پڑا رہا، کس طرح سے ہم سائے میں آ کے بیٹھ سکتے. لعنة اللہ علی القوم الظالمین سیعلم الذین ظالموا ای منقلب ینقلبون. خداوند اس قرض بار قبول فرما، ہمارے گناہوں کو بخش دے، ہماری توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما. خداوند اس ذکر قرآن اور اہل بیت کا ثواب جن مرحومین کے ایصال ثواب کی مجلس ہیں اور کی روح کو بخش دے، ان کے گناہوں کو معاف فرما، ان کے درجات کو بلند فرما، ان کو محمد آل محمد کے ساتھ محشور فرمانا، ان کے گھر والوں کو صبر جمیل کی توفیق عنایت فرما. خداوندہ جتنے مومنین یہاں موجود ہیں، خداوندہ ان کو بھی ان کی توفیقات میں بھی اضافہ فرما. جہاں جہاں شیعان علی ہے، خداوندہ ان کو اپنے حفظ امان میں رکھ اور امام کے ظہور میں تعجیل فرما. ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السمیع العلیم.